Welcome everyone to our YouTube series, Test Prep Made Easy. So in this particular series, we are going to post regularly questions on our YouTube channel. The questions may pertain to CAT preparation, may be pertaining to GMAT preparation, as well as of various topics which are tested in these particular exams. For example, Quants, LRDI, English, and various areas which are tested. And each day, we will handle certain number of questions and their video solutions. The best approach is to these questions in these videos. So have a happy preparation ahead and enjoy the video. Thank you.
All right, so these are the questions that we are going to try in today's video. If you have tried it already from the thumbnail, good enough. If you haven't, you can pause the video at this point and try it once before you look into the solutions. We recommend you doing that. But if you just want to enjoy the solution, that's also good enough. And go ahead and watch the solutions now. All right. A very, very simple problem, but a very interesting one at that matter. So you have this... You have to find the number of maximum number of consecutive integers that could add up to 76. So as soon as you read this maximum, you should try to understand that we are tending to figure out as many integers as we can. But also another thing you should be understanding out here, in terms of the constraint. So we are looking for consecutive integers. So we have to add consecutive integers. We cannot just take any number of integers for that matter. But it says integers. It doesn't say positive integers. So if I take consecutive integers equal in magnitude and opposite in sign. So for example, if I take something like -1, 0, and 1, this adds up to 0, right? Similarly, if I take -2 here, and a +2 here. These are also consecutive. And this is also adding up to 0. So the idea is pretty simple. So what you do is you take up to -75 on the negative side and you take up to +75. So this entire block will add up to 0. There's nothing to it. And then you just take the 76. You don't take the -76. So effectively this part being 0, when all of this is added, the sum should actually be equal to 76. So all you have to do is just figure out how many numbers are here. So there are 75 negative numbers, 1, 0, of course, and 76 positive numbers. So a total of 75 plus 1 plus 76. So that is equal to 152. So this question could very well come without options if that is a pattern for the specific exam. But anyhow, that's all for this question. Very simple one. An interesting one, of course, but a very, very simple one. So thanks for joining in. That's it for this problem. All right. So ideally, this is just a calculation thing. There's not too much to it. It's just that how we are viewing this difference. So we are looking for x minus y, where the x is this entire thing and the y is this entire thing. We are trying to figure out the value of x minus y. So we need to subtract it, but we need to subtract it the smartest way possible. So that is the only thing you have to understand in this problem. So let us write this x and y separately. And I'm going to create some levels. Now, the first thing that I'm observing is this 1 in the y and this 53 in the x has nothing multiplied to it. So let me leave this 1 and 53 separately. Let me just write the remaining things for x and y. So for x, we have this 1 into 2, the first term. Then we have the 3 into 4, the 5 into 6. This goes on till 51 into 52. And of course, you have that extra 53 in x. Now, when I'm writing this y, I'll write this 1 at the very end. So I'll just start with this 2 into 3. Then we have the 4 into 5. Then we have the 6 into 7. And this goes on till 52 into 53. Now, before you do this, always make sure that you have same number of terms in these two things. I mean, you can't just assume that that's the same level. you have to understand that whether there's equal number of terms or not. So first thing that you notice, by the way, let me write this one before I explain this. So first thing that I notice is, notice that there's a two common between these two terms. There's a four common between these two terms. There's a six common between these two terms and so on till this last one. I'm ignoring the 53 and one. So the last one, you have this 52 common, right? So we can assume that these terms in X ranges from, you know, 2, 4, 6 and so on till 52, right? This is 52, by the way. So 2, 4, 6 up to 52. Same thing, we can do it for Y as well, because every term has these numbers. So again, there's a parity out here, right? It ranges from 2, 4, 6 up to 52. So now you can easily understand that, yes, there are equal number of terms out here. And once you observe that the commonality out here, so you have this 2 common, 4 common and so on. So when you take a difference of these two, you should be able to understand that this is nothing but 2 into 1 minus 3, which is -2 into 2, because this will be negative. Similarly, this is 4 into 3 minus 5. So this is -2 into 4. So you have -2 into 4. Then again, this is 6 common, 5 minus 7. Again, this is -2 into 6. So you have the same pattern happening, right? So this is -2 into 6. So this goes on up to -2 into 52. That is the last one. Just take a difference of these two numbers. So you have a +52 additionally to it. So all you have to do is just simplify this. So you have to use a summation formula. I hope you're aware of it. So what I'm going to do is, in order to simplify this a little bit more, I'll take a -2 into 2 common. And then this becomes 1 plus 2 plus 3 up to 26, right? So I'm taking 2 common from each of these numbers as well. So that ranges up to 52 by 2, which is 26, right? So do you have this +52 any which way? So just simplify this. So you have -4, and I hope you know the summation formula of 1 to n, which is n into n plus 1 by 2. So that is 26 into 27 upon 2 plus 52. So this is all you're solving for. Observe another thing out here. This is again a bit of simplification. So this is 4 by 2 is 2. Into 26 will give us 52, right? So this is nothing but something like this, -52 into 27. This part resolves to that. And then you have a +52. So all you have is something like -52 into 26, right? Because this one you can imagine as 52 into 1, which is added to it, and it's a negative 1. So you'll have -52 into 26. So if you're aware of 26 square, then the calculation becomes a little simpler. Because there are a couple of options with last digit of 2. So I'm just avoiding the calculation. So 26 square is 676 into 2 will be 1352. So that is negative of 1352. So that's all for this problem. I hope this was understood, because ideally it's a very, very easy problem. Just how you're simplifying it, you know, will ultimately lead to how much time you have spent to solve this question. So the better you simplify, the faster you can solve it. Don't rush into solving it. Just simplify it properly. Time taken will automatically reduce. So that's it from my end. I hope everything was understood. Thank you. Well, this is a problem on factors. That is the main concern here. But it's a very nice problem. It has been well put. So let us once read the question, and then I'll discuss what is the working approach that will go in my mind when I'm reading the question, when I'm solving it. So you have been given a set A. So set A is all natural numbers from 1 to 12, basically. 6 of these integers are being selected to form set B. So set B, we don't know. It's a subset of set A. So we need to pick up 6 integers from this set to form the set B. Now, this is the constraint, such that no number in set B is a multiple of any other number in set B. So basically, if I take any two random numbers in set B, one of them should not be a multiple of the other one. For instance, I cannot pick up something like 4, 5, 8, 9, 11, and something, let's say 12. this is violating two of the cases. So let me just take 10 and 11. So from this standpoint, you'll find that couple of issues are there. So 4 is a multiple, 8 is a multiple of 4, and 5, 10 is a multiple of 5. This is not allowed. Even if you don't have couple of these issues, so you can't even have something like this. So the only problem here is 10 is a multiple of 5. But that is not allowed. So you cannot form a set B like this. So no number should be a multiple of any other number in that set. That is a set B. So that is a constraint. So we have to do something with set B. So just understand this while you're reading it. Now it says we have to find the difference between the maximum and minimum sum of the elements of set B. So ideally, if I need to maximize the sum of the elements, we'll try to take the numbers as high as possible. And similarly, when I'm trying to minimize the sum, I'll take each number as low as I can, right? So let's work on the maximum thing first, because this is a very interesting idea on in terms of factors. This is something I explain in classes. It's a very basic idea, but if you understand the importance of it, it's a very, very strong idea. The idea is that for any number, the highest factor, this most of you will know, is itself. And the second highest factor can never exceed the exceed half the number. So let me put it in this way. So for any number, let's say n. So for the second highest factor will be less than or equal to n by 2. So it has to be half or less than it. So for instance, you take any number for that matter. If you take 48, the highest factor of 48 is 48. The second highest factor will be 24, you know, bang half of this number. But if you take an odd number, for instance, let's say 49, 49 is 2, this thing. Let me take, for example, 145 or something. Yeah. So if I take 145, the highest factor is 145 itself. But the second highest factor, what you'll find is 145 divided by, this is not a multiple of 3. So 5. Okay. So you have 29. So second highest factor, you can see it is much lower than the than half of 145. 145 half will be 72.5, right? So 29 is less than that. So the second highest factor will be either equal to half of the number or less than half of the number. So that is why I've written it as less than equal to. Now, this is a very strong idea. And it will be useful in this question when I'm concerned with the maximum possible sum of set B. So what I'm noticing is set A has 12 numbers. And for set B, I have to pick up 6 integers, which is half of it, right? So if I pick up all the numbers that is on the higher half or the highest 6 numbers of A. So it is naturally that, half of any of these numbers is not going to be present, because what you'll find is 6 just missed out, right? I mean, we did not consider 6. If I would have taken 6, then 12 could not have been picked up. But because I'm picking from 7 to 12, no number will be a factor of any other number. Or in other words, no number will be a multiple of any other number, right? So this will automatically maximize the sum. And just calculate that quickly. So you have 7 and 12, 19, 8 and 11, 19, 9 and 10, also 19. So 3 times 19, so that is 57. So that is the maximum sum. Now, for minimum sum, the idea should be to try and eliminate. So from here on, we will try and eliminate higher values and replace it with as low values as possible. So when I'm trying to eliminate something, I'll try to replace it with some other number, which will be, as low as we can take. So let me explain that visually. So first thing, what I'm noticing is, if I eliminate 12, now, what are the other numbers that we have not considered? So just check that out. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So these are the numbers we did not consider in the maximum. So let's keep a note of that. So when I'm eliminating 12, let's say that is the highest number in this maximum possibility. Now I can actually introduce six, I can introduce four, I can introduce two, right? Now think about which you can introduce so that the constraint does not break. So what are the constraints? So one is, of course, the main constraint, which is explicitly written, that the no number should be multiple of any other number. But of course, there's another constraint which we know that, but then sometimes you forget while we are solving the question, and that is the set B must have six integers. So if I'm introducing something or any one number from here into the set, I should ensure that all the multiples of that numbers are also taken off. So for instance, if I introduce 12 and or remove 12 and introduce 2. By the way, I did not say something earlier. I hope that is understood. One can never be taken in set B, right? Because if I introduce one, every other number will definitely be multiple of one. So don't even consider one at all. So if I exclude 12 and try to include 2, now the problem is there are other multiples of 2 in this set as well, and that being 8 and 10. So I have to exclude 8 and 10 as well. So now the situation is I have the 7, I have the 9, and I have the 11, right? But I have to introduce two other numbers. I cannot include 8, 10 anymore. I have to include two other numbers from these four numbers, right? Now just check this out. Because I have this 9, I cannot include the 3. 4 is a multiple of 2. So 4 also cannot be introduced. And if I introduce 5, that just makes a total of 5 numbers so far. Now I can introduce 6 as well because this 2 is already there. So the problem with introducing 2 is I cannot make 6 numbers, which is satisfying the constraint, one number not being a multiple of the other number. So once I exclude 12, I cannot include 2, right? That is, I hope, understandable. Now 3 is also a factor of 12, by the way. Let's try with 3. So if I do introduce 3, same process, I have excluded 12. So any other multiple that I have in this set, I should exclude. So let me exclude 9 as well. So these are the numbers remaining, right? Now, if I check this out, I just have to introduce one other number. But now there's a problem. The problem is I cannot include 4 because 8 is already there. I cannot include 5 because 10 is already there. And I cannot include 6 because 6 is a multiple of 3. So whichever number I introduce, that is an issue. So I can't introduce any other number, and it's the same problem. I'm not being able to form 6 numbers. So 3 also cannot be introduced. So let us try to introduce 4. Now, if I introduce 4, I have to take off 8. 10 is not a problem because 10 is not a multiple of 4. So I just have to exclude 8. So let us do that. So I keep 7, 9, 10, and 11. Now I have to introduce one other number, right? Now in this situation, I can actually introduce 6, right? So understand that 2 and 3 we have already figured out cannot be introduced. So if I introduce 6, that is not an issue, but there is a problem here. We are trying to minimize the sum, isn't it? But we still have this 10, 11, and 9 left out. So can we try to reduce this a little more further? That should be something you should ask yourself. So for example, okay, I have introduced a 6 into it. Let me keep that 6 here. What if I introduce a 5 as well and exclude this 10? Now, this seems quite comfortable, isn't it? So we already have all these 3 numbers which were not there in the maximum. And we have just 3 numbers which was there in this particular set. So I cannot reduce this further because already we know that 1, 2, 3 cannot be taken at all. Otherwise you will not be able to form 6 numbers. So any which way, this is the best case possibility, right? So 4, 5, 6 are lowest that we can actually pick up. And along with that, as soon as I pick up 4, the 8 cannot be taken. As soon as I pick up 5, the 10 cannot be taken. And because I've taken 4 as well as 6, so 12 also cannot be taken. So this should be the the numbers which will form the minimum possible sum. We cannot take anything below it. So that should give you the answer. So just add it up. So you have 4, 5, 6 is adding up to 15. 9 and 11 is 20. And then you have the 7. So 15 plus 7 is 22 plus 20 is 42. So this is the maximum possible sum and this is the minimum possible sum. We are looking for the difference. So the difference will be 15. So something to work out with. If you face a question like this in any exam, so it might appear in CAT, or even questions like these have appeared in Zat earlier as well. My suggestion will be, because you know a bit of trial and error will be involved, for the maximum part, it's very easy, because out of the 12, you have to select six, you can just take the highest six. That itself will validate the constraint. But for the minimum one, you have to make a bit of trial and error and check it out. So that might take a bit of time. So it's better you mark it for review and try it later on if you're interested to solve this question in the exam. Don't solve it in the first scan. Solve the easier ones than this in the first scan. But an interesting problem, definitely an interesting one. That's it from my end. I hope everything was understood. Thank you for joining in. This is a very, very interesting problem. It's a very simple problem, but people might get confused just the way the question has been put in. So let us handle each and everything in a very, very simple manner. There's nothing too much to this problem. The first statement says X is the largest number that is equal to its number of factors. Now, let's handle this thing first, and then we'll move into the Y. There are two things here. X is the largest number that is equal to its number of factors. Now, consider any number. If you take the number to be anything, even a double digit or something, so let's consider 12 or something. Just consider this argument. From the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 12, not all of them will be factor of 12, right? So if I had all of these numbers as factor of 12, only then, you know, the number of factors would also have been 12, right? So 1 to 12, there are 12 numbers. So if all of these numbers had been factors of 12, only in that case, you know, the number would have been equal to the number of factors, what the constraint tells us, right? So you cannot have a big number. So the idea is, if you, you know, rephrase this thing, the idea should be that if the number is X, so 1, 2, X, all the numbers should be factors of X. Only then this is possible. Because if you just use this argument that I explained, if you count all the numbers from 1 to x, that will be x in number, right? And because the number of factors should be equal to x, so all of these should be actually factors of x. No factor of a number can be actually bigger than the number, right? You cannot have a factor of 12 which is greater than 12. So which numbers you know, qualify this criteria? All the numbers should be factor of x, 1 to x, all the numbers. If you just think about it, you will find a couple of numbers, 1 and 2. So only for these two numbers, you know, one obviously has one factor and two has one factor, both one and two. If you take three as well, it has just two factors, one and three. It doesn't have two as a factor. So number of factors of three will be two, right? Same with four. You will have one as a factor, two as a factor, four as a factor, but three will not be a factor. So number of factors will be three. So that parity is not happening. So X can be one or two. Now, since we are talking about the largest number, so we should pick up 2, right? So X is 2 basically, not 1. So that is figured out. So X is done. So let me just take this part off. And now let us look at the Y thing. Now it says Y is the largest two-digit number, which is 1 less than its sum of factors. Now, same idea. So if I consider any number for that matter, so let's consider 12 itself. What are the factors of 12? 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, and 12, right? So these are the factors of 12. So if I add these up, then this number or this 12 will actually not be equal to 1 less than this thing, right? Because what you're finding is if you remove this 1, so if this 1 cancels off, you have these extra factors in between 1 and 12, right? So only when, you know, this Y is a prime number. So take any prime number, for example. So if I consider, let's say, 47. So 47 has just two factors, 1 and 47, right? So if I remove one from this, so this is the sum of factors, by the way, one and 47 are the two factors. So if I subtract one from this sum of factors, so that's what it says, right? Y is the largest, okay, the largest part, which is one less than the sum of factors. So this is the sum of factors, one less than that will actually be Y, will actually be this 47, isn't it? So Y should be a prime number. That is what the question indirectly tells us. And it's the largest two-digit prime number. So which is the largest two-digit prime number? That is 97. So Y is 97, X is 2. We are looking for the difference between Y and X. So just take a difference of 97 and 2. The answer will be option C. So pretty interesting problem. It's just a different way of writing something that you will be familiar with. So you know what's a prime number, but this is just a property of prime number written in a different way. You don't have to mug up the property. Just think very logically. You'll always figure it out. Just take relevant examples and check it out what is happening. So you should identify what is not happening and what you're tending to do. So when I took this 12 as an example here, so what I found was if I add the factors and then subtract one, I'm not getting 12. My target is to get back the Y, right? I'm getting these extra thing. So all I have to do is just not include these extra things. So how do I do that? I cannot choose which is a factor of a number, right? So basically you should not have anything between one and the number. And that is only possible for a prime number. You'll automatically figure it out. So just think logically and you will be able to figure out these kind of questions very, very simply. So that's it for this problem. I hope everything was understood. Thanks for joining in.
Hopefully you liked the solutions we provided for these questions. And if you did like it, do not forget to like the video and share, subscribe and comment. Do subscribe to the channel and click on the bell icon. In that case, you'll get notification as soon as we upload a new video. And if you want to check a bouquet of courses that we provide, so we have a huge variant of courses from customizability to full preparation, you can check our website, www.mathoratory.com. I'll leave the link in the description below. And have an enjoyable preparation ahead. Welcome to the Mathoratory family and have a good exam ahead.